How's it going, party people? My name is Shannon, and today we have a review, and I am so excited for this game because it probably has to be my most anticipated game of the year, Resident Evil Village. We've got Ethan Winters, vampires, werewolf type thingies, and flying gargoyles, and supervillains that remind me a lot of the Hunter from Rescuers Down Under. All the things that I really look forward to in the Halloween season, but will happily play in the spring season when the baby ducks are in their prime cuteness and things are starting to come back to life. So let's dive into the latest installment of Resident Evil and see how we did. If you like today's video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and subscribe so that you can stay up to date on the Sailor Single Player channel. All right, let's do this.
So as I had mentioned earlier, Resident Evil Village had to be my most anticipated game for 2021, and maybe the PS5 lineup in general. And I'm happy to report, at least for myself, it did not disappoint. While I don't have a PS5, I was able to play on my PS4 Pro, and I just have to thank the universe for not making this game a PS exclusive. I don't know if it had to be our interesting range of villains, the mix of simple combat and puzzles, but I'd constantly find myself at the edge of my seat, pushing through the game to see what happened next for the folks of the village and our sad protagonist Ethan Winters and his struggle bus limbs. Picking up from Resident Evil Biohazard, you play as Ethan Winters and join him in his quest to locate his kidnapped daughter trapped in the mutant-infested village. Now, I hadn't played Resident Evil Biohazard before tackling Village, but it sounds like this is a reoccurring issue with Ethan and his inability to keep track of his loved ones. Not that it's anything of bother or anything like that, just seems like a thing. The game does offer to give you a brief synopsis of Biohazard before you start Village, but honestly, I would just say watch a video or two on the story and you'll be totally fine. So getting into the game, I'd have to give my top shout out to the story and layout of the game itself. Once I had moved out of the intro and into the actual village, my curiosity was fully piqued. I was excited to learn more about the characters of the game and what possibly could have happened in the village to lead it to its uncertain events. The game does kind of leave the player guessing on the events that took place in the village for a good bit of the game up until the final info dump in the final act. But honestly, with everything going on between the vampires and multiple bosses, I didn't mind too much. If anything, I was more focused on moving about the different maps in the game and upgrading my weapons because that's just where my attention was. Now, to give a little bit of context, I would consider myself a seasonal fan of horror films and the horror genre in general. I enjoy horror films, but typically steer clear of horror games and haunted houses because I like my jump scares to be presented to other folks and not so much me, like you'd experience in a horror game or haunted house. Luckily for me, the jump scares in Resident Evil Village were pretty minimal, and the game leans more on action than actual fright. Not to say horror moments aren't there, there definitely are, but from my experience, the suspense and tension kind of came more from the feeling that there was something going to come out at me at any moment from playing in first person than it actually did. And about halfway through the game, that feeling was pretty much gone entirely. For me, it felt like a good chunk of the gameplay came from the actual combat, and I have to admit, I kind of liked it. It felt as though the heavy combat from the wave of enemies I encountered kept the tempo of the game at a steady pace and allowed for more high energy moments than what I'd expect from more horror survival games that rely more on stillness and stealth, such as Alien Isolation, which, if you were curious, I wasn't a big fan of. Not saying that the game doesn't belong in the horror genre, it certainly does. It's got your mutant creatures, darker tones and environments, and tension. I mean, front-facing, it fits into my idea of horror. Just the experience itself doesn't give you that tight and sweaty palm feeling you'd get if you were actually in a frightful situation. Again, I think that's totally fine coming from a player who doesn't want things popping out at them left and right and appreciates having the ability to go to sleep soundly at night after I've put the game away for the evening. Kind of a side note, I do have to give Resident Evil Village a shout out for having some of the grossest moments I've come across in my game playing adventure so far. I definitely had some stank face moments and I give Resident Evil a gold star. So let's talk a little bit more about the actual gameplay. From the get-go, you'll find Ethan is going to spend a good amount of time going toe-to-toe with the many creature residents of the village. From that, the game relies really heavily on looting in order to keep your resources and ammo up. Moment of pause, hands down, I kinda really enjoyed the looting. Okay, hear me out for a second, because if you've seen any of my other review videos, you know I really struggle looting and feel like it can really ruin the pacing of a game. In the case of Resident Evil Village, however, I really didn't have an issue with looting interfering with the pace. In a way, the looting was kind of nice because it was an opportunity to have a brief pause before moving further on into the story. If you're familiar with the mechanics of Resident Evil, then you already know how valuable looting and upgrading your weapons are. Ammo is limited and you have to be tactful or else you'll find yourself in a pretty sticky situation where you're taking on a horde of vampires or zombies, so rather than set poor Ethan up for failure, it's just best to go through those cabinets and drawers and take the loot when you can. I think this also may have worked in my benefit because to not loot areas and gather as much materials when you have the opportunity to allowed me to go back and find certain treasures that became very helpful further along in the game. This kind of became a fun little hack as I didn't have to continue to use my level 1 pistol on high level bosses. As I moved about the map and stashing items left and right, I had to keep in mind that given this is a Resident Evil game, space in my inventory is also going to be fairly limited. While I would always side on gathering as many basic items as possible, such as your ammo, your metal scraps, and health aids, sadly I couldn't just let my inventory go wild on specialty items I'd find in treasure maps. I found that during my time, exchanging and upgrading items with the merchant became more and more of a puzzle based on my allotment of ammo, engaging what was likely to be more easily accessible in the village world, and what wasn't. Like, given how awesome a certain specialty gun is and how powerful it is, what was the likelihood of finding or crafting enough ammo that it would be viable against your standard handgun? Is it best to sell this item to the merchant or upgrade it to do more damage to the vampires? These are things I never thought I'd question in a video game. Looting aside, players will also find themselves moving about to numerous different maps and areas throughout the game. Each boss in the game inhabits their own area. From gothic castles for Lady Demetrex and her three buggy daughters to the warehouse and dollhouse for Miss Donna and Angie Benvenuto, each area will come with its own playstyle and puzzles to overcome. I kind of like the different approach to the game styles. While you'll find the dollhouse estate operates more like an escape room, Lady Demetrex felt similar to my experience in the police station in Resident Evil 2 and Mr. X. They both kind of stalk around the map and force players to be hyper aware of their surroundings. The only difference really, however, was that Miss Tall Lady isn't stomping around in rubber boots to give players a heads up to her location. It felt like with each boss and map, the vibe of the game could really remain fresh and interesting since odds are this would be the player's first time around in the new space, and they all operate a little different. Some levels don't fully come up to par with the others in terms of layout and just the general experience, but I was still able to take something away from each, and none of them really left a bad taste in my mouth. So all in all, it's fairly safe to say that I greatly enjoyed Resident Evil Village and would recommend it for most players out there. There are a few things to kind of mention that probably could have used a little bit of tweaking, but altogether, they don't pull too much away from the general gameplay. First, as much as I enjoyed the story and felt the events in the game were pretty well fleshed out, the writing in certain areas felt a little weak. For the most part, I really enjoyed all the characters. The one that I probably had the biggest issue with in terms of writing probably came down to Ethan. The delivery of some of his lines felt really off-putting, and perhaps he was a little lost for words but needed to express some type of emotion, but we don't want to do any R-rated language because Baby Rose could be out there listening someplace, so we'll just go with a PG-13 rating on some things. Unless it was absolutely necessary, it felt at times it would have been better for Ethan to kind of just keep to himself, rather than give him much, if any, dialogue. It felt like there was a lot of time invested in crafting the majority of the characters the player would be facing on the front end, but Ethan was kind of an afterthought. Perhaps this has to do with him not having a face. I'm not sure. My other thought came from most of the combat as well. Perhaps this had to do with my difficulty level, but it felt like at times the NPCs you'd end up battling fared more on the easy slash sluggish side than actual quick responses. I noticed throughout my gameplay there was a lot of pausing in between actions that made it pretty predictable and easy to point out the best mode of attack throughout the game. If I was ever struggling in a battle, it seemed like more often than not, it came from the sheer volume of enemies attacking poor Ethan, and not so much my lack of combat strategy. Again, not things that were like huge deal breakers, but something I did notice. So I think that's essentially all of my thoughts on Resident Evil 8. It felt like a good amount of horror for myself. While it does rely more on action rather than suspense, it still has other horror elements that I think most folks wouldn't have a hard time getting their genre fix from. It was absolutely wonderful to play through, and I could see myself giving it another playthrough in perhaps a higher difficulty level. I found most of the characters and the story in the game pretty intriguing and would be willing to go back to previous games to dive more into the Resident Evil lore. I'm excited to see what's next for Team Resident Evil and perhaps even the Winter storyline, but we shall see. Thank you so much for tuning into my video on Resident Evil Village. What are your thoughts on the game? Leave your thoughts in the comment box below. For everyone that made it this far in the video, thank you so much again, and I will see you guys next time for the next video. Bye! Thank you.